Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of Investing in
Huntsville,
the Rocket City.
Or Northern Alabama.
Northern Alabama. You know, we say that because that's where we are, but really what we talk about is good anywhere, pretty much.
You could plug it in anywhere.
Yep.
Unless you're in like California or New York or Seattle or South Florida, you just got to raise all your prices on cost of goods.
You just do a multiple of four or five. Yeah.
I always tell people just add a zero.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah. So, yeah, well, it's one of the things that that is unique about this market is the investing opportunities here. So that's 100%. What we talk about a lot. This is episode, I think, five or six.
Somewhere around there.
I lose count after a while. So Zack Childress, how are you, buddy?
Doing amazing. Busy as always. Taking down more deals, lending more money, doing what I do.
And you just took a few days off, and I bet you did deals while you were out of town.
You know, that's funny. I was trying not to, but they just kept coming in.
The kids are going, Daddy, Daddy.
Well,
Daddy.
You know, I find my moments because, you know, we have like breaks when we're on vacation where I let them go get on their phone. So I kind of do, when they're on theirs, I'm grabbing mine. That's and I'm funny. Like, all right, let's set closing up for this day.
Right? So you really can't enforce the no phone time thing.
Right.
Yeah,
right,
I know. I'm the same same way. So, see, what the Pigeon Forge?
Gallimer? Yes, we stayed in, I can't ever say it, Sevierville at the water park, which I'm such a dummy. I didn't even realize the water park was closed.
Yeah, it is winter.
It was winter. And I get there and it's all shut down. They're like, yeah, it's not open. So we had an amazing view out of our porch of a water park with no water in it.
You're kind of like a, who was it, vacation? You like drive across the country to go to Wally World, right. And Wally World is closed.
That was me. That was totally me.
That is so
but
funny.
We did a lot of cool stuff. We got some indoor skydiving in.
Love that.
Did some rope tree bridges. It was a lot of fun.
We were just talking. The last time I was in Gatlinburg, Pigeon Forge, was my daughter Sierra's. Went there for her 16th birthday, just me and her. She's 27 now, I think. But we did the indoor skydiving, which we were just hooked on. We would stay there for hours, and we'd go back every day. Did they have the, was it the Dixie Stampede? Did you go to that?
We've been to all those.
Oh, those are so good.
We've been to the Pirate Show, the Dixie Stampede, the, what is it? The family feud between...
Hatfields and the McCoys.
Hatfields and McCoys. This time we did the Lumberjack feud. I mean, so we love all those shows and dinners.
Yeah, I love, man, the food, though. That...
I'm not a big fan of the food. I'll just tell you. I'm not.
Holy
it's
moly.
All fried. It's all heavy loaded. And
point being what?
That I
hey,
just don't
the,
like
the
that.
Zack 3 or 4 years ago would be
I'd
eating
ate
the
mine,
shit
the
out
kids,
of that food.
Whoever left theirs on their plate.
That's funny. So, all right. So on this podcast, what we do is we talk about investing in general, but investing in Huntsville specifically. We've kind of been following a line.
Yeah.
kind of a sequential
growth.
Exactly. So last week we talked about the team.
Yes.
I think the week before that we talked about funding.
Yep.
What do you want to talk about today?
Well, I think if you follow the path, and once you have all the foundation, you've got your markets understood, you got your buy box in place, you got your funding in place, you understand who's on your team. Now it's time to go find deals.
Go find something to do.
Let's something go to make play. Some money.
Yeah. Explain what you mentioned one thing, buy box. Mm-hmm. Define that.
That was the show we did in the conference room.
Okay.
And so buy box is like, once you really know, like, the area you want to invest in, now you got to figure out what is it that you want to do.
What type of property?
What type of properties? What price range? What asset class? And so it's very easy when you're speaking to a broker, an agent, or even a commercial broker. You can't just say, like we hear a lot of investors say, oh, just send me a good deal.
Yeah.
Well, that tells you
what
very clearly, like they don't have a buy box, right? Mm-hmm. And so they're going to pass on more than they buy versus you go right to a professional person like yourself, a broker, an agent, you say, hey, here is my buy box.
Mm-hmm.
So when an agent comes to me and they say, Zack, what are you looking for? I want to buy anything that I can flip that's distressed, that's a 3-1 or greater, that has an ARV no more than 350.
Gotcha.
Right? So now they're like, okay, these are the areas. And I'll even give them the zip codes. Like these are the zip codes I'm looking for.
Mm-hmm.
And then here's the type of rentals I look for. So that's really a buy box, right? Is to be clear on that.
Really, it's your parameters.
It is.
That's
it
what
is.
It is. Yeah. Here's my box. So.
Here's what I'm looking for.
All right.
For.
So let's go find some deals. Starting from someone who, let's say, no budget, got some time. Yeah. Talk about how the best way to get started.
Well, I think you said what you just said right there is probably more important is when we start out in investing, and I'm just going to say that you're brand new and you're learning and by the way, I just want to say thank you. I've been getting so many Facebook messages.
Have you?
Good. That people are like, "Hey, I'm following you. You and Tim's videos are great." Awesome. And it's like people I don't even know. So yeah. That's awesome.
Yeah.
But I think when you're new and you're starting out, one thing you just said is what's your budget?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm a big believer. I go against the grain with a lot of these YouTube university and TikTok stars. I don't think you should be spending money when you first start out.
Right.
Because you're basically spending dollars to acquire leads that you're practicing on. Mm-hmm. And it's wasted money.
You don't know what you're doing yet.
You don't. And so I'm a believer that there's two categories of leads. There's paid leads and there's free leads. And I've been teaching this for almost a decade and a half. Mm-hmm. Is that when you first start out, I don't care if you make $1 million a year. I really don't. Mm-hmm. You should always start with free leads because there's a framework you have to learn, which we call the lead intake process. So when you do marketing and a lead comes in, it moves into a lead intake, which is communicate, research, analyze, and then negotiate. Well, when you're paying for leads and you don't really understand the frameworks inside communication or even research and analyze, and you mm-hmm. haven't, and you're not able to do that fast, you're wasting dollars on that, where some people will say, "Oh, just go buy a big list, skip trace it, put it in a dialer,
make some phone
calls."
Yeah,
make phone calls. And the problem, you're spending all this money trying to learn mm-hmm. the right way to communicate with an off-market lead.
Yeah,
and it's much different than an on-market lead. And we talk about public and private leads through this because, like a public lead, your agent brings to you, there is no communication with the seller. It mm-hmm. is run your numbers, make an offer, mm-hmm. and that's pretty much what it is. So into lead flow, we always say, look. You, part of your team building is agents because they're going to send you stuff. Mm-hmm. And that's an amazing lead source, especially when you get with a good agents that are out there digging up deals.
Right.
But it's also our job as an investor to remember we're in control of lead flow.
Mm-hmm.
If I had a wise mentor once say to me a long time ago, he said, "Zach, where do you get your leads from?" I said, "My agent." He said, "Oh, you're a parasite marketer." And I was like, "What? Like,
that's
what,
good.
What does that mean?" He goes, "Oh, so if your agent doesn't bring you leads, then you don't have any deals."
Right.
And it hit me. I was like, "Oh my goodness. I'm solely dependent on one lead source." Mm-hmm. And that was when I spent years digging into marketing and understanding all the aspects of generating leads. And so to circle back around, when we're first starting out, we always start with free leads. And we do that to practice.
Yeah.
Right?
Let me ask you this though, because we may need to just back up a little bit because you're making an important point. Before you're even out there beating the bushes for leads, you need to know what you're going to do with those leads.
Of course.
Here's like in my world, you know, in real estate, when I have new agents interview with Revolved, a lot of them are like, I'm ready. give me a lead. And the thing about it is they're not ready.
No.
They got their license. They might've watched a couple of YouTube videos. Yep. And what I asked them, I said, "Okay, if I say, hey, here's a lead, what would you do next?"
Yes.
Every one of them goes,
I don't know.
So 100%. It may be that even before you're out there looking for leads, it's more about learning what to do and the education part.
Yeah,
you know?
It is. And look, when I onboard someone that like wants a coach or wants some consulting, one of the very first questions I ask them is I say, "Hey, what are we going to be specializing in?
Mm-hmm.
What's the goal here? Like, why are we doing this?" And, you know, almost all of them say cash flow. "I want to build cash flow. I want to build cash flow. And I'm saying, "Okay, great. So that's the goal. We want to build cash flow. Are you sitting on a ton of money to go buy rentals?" Mm-hmm. "No." "Okay, then we have to have a feeder machine." And so a feeder machine is like rehabbing, wholesaling. Those are transactional based strategies that create capital so that we can go feed into our rental portfolio.
Right.
And so they kind of work hand in hand. So I'm always encouraging people, you know, to think about what the end goal is first.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you just want to create cash and not worry about cash flow, then man, rehabbing is the way to go.
Mm-hmm.
If the goal for you is rentals and you're not sitting on a lot of capital, then you need to rehab a few houses to keep funding the rental purchase and buys.
Yeah. Well, maybe next week we can cover strategies. The education.
Look, part I've of got there. Investing strategies are broken into four tiers.
Okay.
And it doesn't matter what you're going to do, they're all in these four tiers. And I can absolutely talk about that.
Yeah. I mean, do you want to talk about that on this show?
Well, we've already got them moving into lead flow. Let's go on lead flow.
All right, let's go.
So let's go back. So it's really two categories. We always start off with public and private. Private leads are where we really get the best bangs for our buck. Give you an example, private lead on the commercial space. It's worth about $800,000. I'm picking it up for $400,000.
Yeah.
And I was structured seller financing on it, right?
Man, you talking about right place, right time. God's smiling right on you.
Well, and another one. I got another one in Athens. I'm getting it for $90,000. It's worth $160,000. I got another one I'm closing today in Huntsville. I'm getting it for $95,000. It's worth $160,000. Wow. These are all private leads, yeah, right? These are not public, because if they're public, everybody's bidding on them.
Yeah.
And I was the only offer on all these properties, right? Mm-hmm. And that's the difference between public and private. So when we dig into private leads, we start everybody with understanding free lead sources. So what is a free lead source? It's anything that doesn't cost you money. So it's getting on the phone and calling agents and seeing if they know you or don't know you. It's calling management companies to see if there might be a way to get your name on their distribution list. Mm-hmm. It's driving around neighborhoods that you want to buy in and looking for distressed properties and putting a note on the door or knocking on the door.
Driving for dollars,
as we say. And I get a lot of students to get deals that way. It's actually getting on and calling Craigslist and emailing for sale by owner sites. It's calling rental ads. It's picking up the phone and calling other wholesalers in the market. It's going to networking events. It's just really getting out there and doing all the footwork to create lead flow for free, for the sole purpose to be able to work your communication skills.
Yeah.
And on my Facebook group, you'll see a lot of my students that have a lot of success, and they always say something very similar. And it's like, hey, we didn't even spend money on marketing. Mm-hmm. Because the fact of it is that even though YouTube spreads this mass knowledge base of buy this system, pay for this marketing, set up the, you don't need that unless the goal for you is to do 4 to 5, 6, 10 deals a month.
Yeah.
If that's your goal, then yeah, you got to ramp up a massive marketing machine. But let's be honest, Tim, most people aren't trying to do that.
Right.
If they do 3, 4, 5 a year, they're ecstatic. Mm-hmm. And if that's the case, the larger you build your free lead network, you'll reach those goals.
Yeah.
You'll absolutely reach those goals.
A lot of that, I'll go back to real estate with new agents. You know, it's the same with us. You can go spend a ton of money on leads, or you can do what I did when I first got into business: phone calls, knocking doors, going out and meeting people, networking. A lot of people are not comfortable doing that. A lot of realtors aren't. Yep. And those are the ones that immediately dive in, start spending thousands of dollars on leads, and quickly find out that the best client is one you find yourself, in my experience. So do you find that the students that you work with, the new investors, they're a little uncomfortable making those initial contacts?
I say it all the time. The hardest job I have as a coach is getting people on the phone.
Exactly.
It is the hardest job, because they get nervous. They don't they play the scenario out in their head that it's going to be bad, 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 bad. But the more I push them, because I always say, look, part of my job is pushing my students past their comfort zone, right? And the more I push them and the more I get them on the phone, they start to ease up. And they're like, okay, this isn't that bad.
Yeah. And the fear of phone calling is real.
I've got this young guy that I'm working with right now, and he's he's in cybersecurity. So he's like on the computer at home all day, and I'm forcing him to get on the phone. Well, here's the irony to it. I kept saying, look, if you just keep getting on the phone, you're going to get a deal. And so he started slow, and I kept pushing him, and now he just landed a killer deal from a phone call to a free lead. I'm shocked. I'm helping him, but we got the seller, and the seller doesn't live here. Okay. Just run through this deal real quick. The seller doesn't live here. It's been vacant for 3 years. It needs about $150,000 in work. But the property is worth, I don't know, $275,000, somewhere around there, $280,000 fixed up. So we went back to the seller and we said, hey, look, it's a lot of money and you're going to have to bring the price way down. And the seller said, well, look, you know, I've got money that I'm in my IRA I got to pull out. We're getting the seller to be the private lender for the construction and put the a subject to in place. So we get deed. He's going to put a mortgage on the property for the 150 and we're doing an equity split at the end. It's a $50,000 each side split.
Mm-hmm.
Cold call.
Yeah.
This young kid, first deal is going to make 50 grand
yeah.
by negotiating the deal correctly, communicating correctly, and getting the seller to be the private on the construction.
When you do your coaching, we're not here to sell coaching. I just want to know, is a large part of that in the beginning, at least, hey, here's what to say when you get someone on the phone?
I teach frameworks.
Okay.
Now, there's scripts out there, and scripts are cool. Don't get me wrong. Mm-hmm. They help give you confidence to get on the phone and start sure. calling. But more importantly than anything is getting off that script and learning the frameworks.
Right.
Because if you're on the script, you tend to sound more like a robot.
Yes.
But if you really break that script down, it's just a framework of a series of things you need to get out of the seller in mm-hmm. the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
And if you learn that framework, then it becomes more fluid.
Gotcha.
And then you can just talk, and you know, okay, I got to get them back to number three, and then you can be more fluid in the conversation. So mm-hmm. I'm big on frameworks.
Yeah, good. All right, so and next week, we're going to talk more about that. So let's get back to
the free leads. Sources, mm-hmm. and there's a plethora of them, right? Yeah. I mean, it is everybody I talk to, I'm always asking, what do you have for, do you know anybody that's selling mm-hmm. anything? Do you know anything? I mean, it just happened at the kid's school. It was a mortgage broker, a lady overheard me talking to her. She was talking about her house, and I said, well, look, that's probably not going to be a good fit, but what else do you know? Oh, my aunt has a property that's been vacant for 2 years. Maybe. Absolutely.
Yeah.
That is the part that people have to build confidence that mm-hmm. they are an investor now.
Yeah. It's amazing what you can find out just by talking.
Just talking.
Just by asking.
Yep. Just talking. And so the free leads is what people will find is, especially if they're really good at calling, they'll get through them very fast,
mm-hmm.
which means they're learning their skill sets. They're learning communication frameworks. They're learning analyzing. Then at that point, we can move over to paid leads.
Okay.
But I always tell everybody, do not go to paid leads until you know that you're getting more and more confident on that phone with the sellers.
Right.
And you're learning how to get the right information, to learn how to analyze quickly. Because let's be honest, speed is everything in this market mm-hmm. when you're paying for leads and you're going after public leads.
Yeah. The other thing to remember, this is 99% of paid leads are not really leads. You've paid for them, though.
Yeah.
You know, you got to put that money out to get that phone number or something. Same way with real estate.
We're all in the marketing business. Yeah. Whether people want to acknowledge that or not, we're all in the marketing business. We're all marketing for leads to be able to turn into clients, customers, or prospects, right?
Mm-hmm.
So one thing I want to touch on real quick is this, is that it's not the amount of leads that you get. I get a lot of people that'll say, oh, well, the leads are bad. No, the leads aren't bad. Your communication skills need work,
mm-hmm.
right? And I talk about this in our how to communicate effectively with sellers class. And what I'm trying to explain to people is it's not the amount of leads, because people will say, oh, well, I can pull 4,000 vacant properties and call all of them. I'm like, why would you do that?
Yeah.
It doesn't make sense. I mean, I could take that 4,000, add a couple of stacks of pain in that list to then turn it down to 400, and I'll get more out of that 400 than that 4,000.
Mm-hmm.
Because more importantly, we have to learn is this. We're not throwing money at a problem. It's okay to take money and put it towards a solution. And mm-hmm. let me explain that mm-hmm. real quick. Because
okay.
people think, oh, the problem is I'm not getting deals, so let me just go get a bunch of leads to call.
Let me throw money at it.
That's throwing money at a problem. Mm-hmm. We want to put money at for a solution. So if I'm saying I'm not getting enough, then I might want to pay for some leads, but have the leads stacked in a specific way that I'm creating a solution that I can solve. And so as real estate investors, when you move into paid leads, you have to remember our number one goal is finding problems we can solve. Mm-hmm. If there is no problem, then we need to refer them to our agent.
Right.
Because yeah. there's no problem for us right. to solve, right? So go to the agent and have them list it and get it at retail. And
so if this house does not match your buy box, it may not be for you, but then you can refer them over to an agent to list.
Yeah, absolutely. And I okay. tell all new investors, get an agent you like, trust, and wants to do business with you and refer as much to them as possible.
Mm-hmm.
'Cause we run into a lot of sellers that just, A, aren't motivated. There is no problem to solve. There's no distress in the house for us to fix up. And they really are looking for a retail buyer, but they're looking for a quick sell. So they come to investors and we just can't pay them what they want. But that's the perfect referral to their agent.
Yeah.
Because the agent can then come in and list it and get that retail.
Yeah, and it's not a wholesale candidate because they want retail price.
That's right. It's not at all. So we talk a lot about this when we move to paid is like we're putting money into paid leads for the purpose to ramp up lead flow, but be strategic about it. And it only works very well when you already know your frameworks of communication, because we don't want to go spend hundreds of dollars on leads that we still don't know how to talk to.
Right.
Right. And then we're stumbling over our words and we don't show confidence. And then the sellers are like, I don't know if I want to do business with you.
Exactly.
You don't seem like you can buy this thing.
Yeah. So what are some of the paid lead sources?
So when you get into paid leads, there's a huge umbrella. One's direct mail. But let's just be clear. Direct mail is like this broad term because under direct mail, you could direct mail to expired listings. You can direct mail to vacants. You can direct mail to water shutoffs. You can direct mail to code violations. You can direct mail to out-of-state owners, foreclosures, probates, inherited. I mean, the list go on.
Where do those lists come from?
Well, you can go to a list site. We have a software that we let people plug into called the Ultimate Investing Software.
Okay.
And you can pull a list in there and do direct mail in there. But it is a list provider.
Okay.
That's very different than a list broker.
Right.
Be clear on that. I use a list broker.
Okay. Difference now, being?
Difference being a list provider, you just go in and pick, you know, where you want your list, what type of list you want, and it spits out a list.
Right.
Where a list broker is a personal relationship.
Okay.
It's somebody that's been in the list aggregation business for years. You pay more because you're hiring their service, but you get a better list back. And you say, hey, we call it stacking. So I might say, hey, I want a list of every vacant property in this county that is non-owner occupant that has a, I don't know, let's just say a tax lien against the property.
And they pull these lists from public records.
And it's all public records. Every bit of it is. And some of the public records are a little bit more in depth. You can't get off of list sites, but brokers can get it. Like code violations or water shutoff. Those are what we call pre-fault signs. But the more we stack it, the smaller the list gets. Right. So people are like, oh, well, it's only this many people. But let me explain something to you.
You're honing down though. You're trimming the fat.
Well, that's what I'm trying to say to people. Yeah. That 4,000 list that you just pulled, you got excited about, the 200 in there that you're going to do business with is the 200 I'm just pulling anyways.
Yeah.
And so we go through list brokers and, you know, they're all over, but it's a broker. You talk to them, but most people won't go that route because it does cost more money.
Talk a little bit about the cost compared to list seller to list broker.
Well, if you use a software
based on the number of names,
if you use a list software like what we have, you can pull the list for free in there. Now you pay a monthly fee for this platform, but it gives you comparables and all kinds of ownership and all that, but you can just pull a list for free in there.
Okay.
If you go to a service like, I don't know, List Source and you pull a list, I mean, you might pay, I don't know, 5 to 20 cents per record, depending on the list. And that's to acquire the list. And then direct mail will cost you anywhere from 60 cents to $5.
Yeah, direct mail being postcards, letters, whatever. Yeah.
Whatever. It could be anywhere from 60 cents, like a postcard, to $5, depending on the envelope and the letter and how it, you know, how much of a splash you want to make.
Is there a style that you found more effective? Because, 100%. And here's why I asked this. I get, because of property that I've owned, I get postcards every week.
I get them too.
And some of them are the big, nice ones. Yep. But then some of them...
Little ugly ones.
Little ugly ones look like they were handwritten.
Yeah. And believe
And I know the guy's sending those out, and he does an enormous amount of business.
I know him too. And here's the reality. We have what's called a stepping process in our paid marketing, like direct mail. And so I'll just give you all a piece of advice. If you're going to do direct mail, and your only intention is to send one piece, just don't do it.
Yeah.
Just don't do it. Because we have a process where the first piece we send is the postcard. And the reason that we do that is to filter the list to see how many of the pieces come back. You know what I mean? So that we know not to mail the next piece to all those lists. But then that list becomes its own list because then we go hunt them down. But from there, we move to a letter. And then we have a different type of letter. And then we send a final postcard. That's
so you're like sending the recipient multiple
mail touches.
Pieces.
Okay. Absolutely, multiple touches. And not just that, but we're sending them to our website, which is another form of marketing, because once they go to our website, we have our Facebook pixels on those. So then when they hit our website, if they log into Facebook, we're running what's called retargeting campaigns.
Mm-hmm.
And so now they go into Facebook and they see our videos following them around.
They get in your vortex.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
So omni approach is what people refer to it as. Mm-hmm. But multiple touches in direct mail and multiple piece styles. Mm-hmm. So we will send the handwritten because it is funny that they actually produce more responses.
Yeah.
But not to an investor.
Right.
Because an investor doesn't really react to that very well. Well, we get to the letter that's a little bit more of a personal letter, we get more responses. But when we get to a professional letter, which is the next batch, so each piece we send out is designed to touch a different prospect.
Mm-hmm.
The postcard, low-lying fruit. The letter, handwritten, now touches the person that needed to see us twice. The professional corporate letter now touches the person that will never do business with the mom and pop, but they're looking to do business with a professional investment company.
Yeah.
And then we send the goodbye letter, which creates FOMO.
You're lost.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, it's funny, but I mean, I would assume that very rarely does anybody go to the mailbox and go, hey, Marge, they want to buy our house.
That's right. They don't. The low-lying fruit, yes.
Yeah.
The highly motivated ones, yes. But it takes a few touches. And that's just direct mail. And then you can get into having cold callers and dialers and skipped marketing messaging. And SMS is another way of saying it. Then you can get door knockers. And then from there, you can get into Google AdSense and then Facebook advertising. And I mean, the list goes on and on. I mean, I've done billboards. I've done TV commercials in this town.
Mm-hmm.
We're constantly testing marketing.
Yeah.
Constantly.
And when you find something that works, you test that.
Dump all the money into it as you can. Yeah. And then what happens is you start testing the assets in that marketing, the colors, the headlines, and you just start tweaking it.
It really is a science.
It is.
And if you don't know what you're doing, you're going to waste a lot of money.
And that's why we tell everybody to start with free leads, because they're not at that level yet, right?
Yeah.
And they don't have the capital to just burn. Like, I did TV commercials here for months, and I probably wasted $30,000.
Yeah, I've been there, done that.
And that's when I realized real quick, okay, well, this market's just not the right market for TV for this type of stuff.
Yeah. Yeah. Same here. I mean, your business is a lot like mine. You know, we do the same kind of thing, postcards, door knocking. The one thing that I see a lot of agents do, and it's a little different, we basically will blanket a neighborhood.
Yeah, farming.
Because we're looking for, you know, sellers and buyers and that sort of thing. So what are some of the mistakes you've seen people make as far as pulling the wrong list, not having a plan? They just pull the list and send out an email to everybody.
Mistake is not answering the phone.
That'll do it.
Listen, it shocks me because, you know, and then there's another form of marketing called bandit signs.
I was going to ask about bandit
signs. I'll drive around town and see bandit signs, and I'll call it because I want to meet them, right?
Yeah.
And I'll leave a message. They'll never call you back.
Yeah.
And then you call 10 of them, one will call you back. And I'm like, why are you paying all this money?
Yeah.
So here's what I always tell people. If you're working a 9-to-5 and you're trying to build this business as a side hustle to get out of your 9-to-5, go pay for a call center.
Mm-hmm. Somebody to make the calls for you.
Well, answer those calls, right? Yeah. Because here's why. If a seller wants to sell, and they see your bandit sign and another bandit sign and another, they're calling yours. And if you don't answer, guess what?
Yeah.
They're going right to the next one.
Yeah.
Same way with agents.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, let me call this agent. I'm going to leave a message. And they don't call them back. They're calling the next agent.
Happens all the time.
And it drives me crazy when people go to paid marketing.
Yeah.
And I'm like, answer. Even when I get direct mail from investors, I always call it because I want to know them.
Right.
And I'll call and leave a message. I don't say, oh, I'm Zack Childress, president of the REIT. I'm just like, hey, I got your postcard. I'd like to talk and see what you guys do. No callbacks.
Yeah. Are bandit signs effective now? I mean, for years, everybody.
I built a business on bandit
signs. Have you really?
Back in the day. Ooh,
yeah.
And I would probably put out 400 or 500 a month.
Wow.
Like
These are just little signs. You stick it in intersections.
Signs that just say, hey, we buy houses for cash. Call us a number.
Yeah.
I built it. And then for years, they went away.
Yeah.
They went away, but they're coming back.
Yeah, City of Madison will pull them up and throw them away.
So now that's the other side of it, right? People are always like, well, mm-hmm. isn't there a sign ordinance? Yes, there is a sign ordinance.
Yeah.
But we don't put them on main roads. We tend to put them towards like the neighborhoods going into the neighborhoods mm-hmm. that we want to buy at.
Yeah.
But also, if you put them out on Friday and pick them up on Sunday,
yeah.
then you are less likely to have your signs
yeah. Well, it used to crack me up because I live in Madison. And there, before they did the sign ordinance, there at Hughes Road and 72, there's an Arby's right there.
Yes.
There would be 3,000 bandit signs. And the thing that always cracked me up about bandit signs is they're usually handwritten, I mean, really sloppy, but they're wanting to buy your house.
So let me.
And I'm like, you can't afford somebody to do a good sign. Works. Is that the strategy?
I've tested the yellow ones, the blue ones, the white ones with red writing, the white ones with blue writing, the black ones with white writing, and then we would handwrite them. Here's what it is: the handwritten ones stayed out longer, and we got more leads from them.
Really? Because people thought it wasn't some company.
Intimidating.
It was an individual.
Intimidating. It wasn't sense. Some big company. It looked like just somebody that was around buying houses. It was so ironic because we did this for years and we didn't start doing the handwritten ones until down the road when we started finding out that our handwritten postcards were getting better response. Mm-hmm.
It's more personal.
Yeah. And I said, well, let's handwrite some bandit signs.
Yeah.
And now there's companies that will actually print them with handwritten on them.
Isn't that funny?
So it works.
You should do an ebook on the bandit sign strategy.
Man, I could do a book could write on it. Marketing.
Why the hell haven't you?
So. I don't know.
All right, so what else? We got probably about 5 minutes left.
So much here. I mean, when you get granular into the marketing, the goal here is this, and I'm just going to, we can kind of wrap this up because I don't have all day. I got a killer boot camp coming up where we dig into this in April. But to wrap all this up, here's what I would tell anybody that's looking at finding great deals. Mm-hmm. Stop looking for them and start listening for them.
Yeah. So what do you mean by, what'd you say, listen and not look?
And it's, yes. And the reason I say listen instead of looking for deals is because it falls into the parameter of, as I'm always saying, stop looking for deals and start creating deals. And the reason that that's important is because deals don't just pop up. We create deals. And the only way we can create a deal is if we listen. Mm. We can't look at it and be like, oh, well, that don't look like a deal. Well, how do you know? Did you talk to them? Did you listen to their problems? Did you find out a solution?
You're too quick to judge.
Instead of getting on the phone, talking, figuring out a solution because you're listening to them. We're in an instant gratification society where we just look, not a deal, pass versus, well, let me call them.
Yeah.
Let me talk to them.
Yeah.
Let me see what's going on here. Like, you know, so I've got some amazing deals that took me 6 months to get closed because I just kept listening and talking and finding a solution through. Number two, I will also tell all new people, if you want to do 10 deals a year, have 10 lead sources. Not one. Mm-hmm. Have 10 different lead sources, all bringing you one deal a year. And that will lower your expectation of having one lead source and trying to squeeze 10 deals out of that one lead source. Mm-hmm. If I want 10, I create 10 lead sources and I say, okay, if I get one deal per lead source a year, then I'm happy.
Right.
And that relieves a lot of the anxiety and stress on trying to squeeze 10 deals out of one lead source.
Okay. So one of the things that every investor needs is patience and the ability to dig in.
The patience is a virtue in this business because you can't. I see too many people make massive mistakes running in just looking for a deal. Mm-hmm. And I say it all the time. Stop looking for deals. Start looking for problems.
Yep.
And the only way you can find a problem is you got to listen.
Got to listen. I know I've had new investors tell me, I just want to find a deal. I just want to, you know what I mean? They're just in such a hurry. And a lot of times they buy houses that are not deals. So next time we talk, I want to talk about due diligence because you got a boot camp coming up on due diligence,
right? Our free monthly meeting next month is all about due diligence.
Okay.
But at the end of April, we do our once a year find and flip workshop.
Okay.
It's a 3-day boot camp. We dig into every aspect of what you need to learn when it comes to finding, fixing, funding, and flipping real estate.
Okay.
It's 3 full days of just, and you get worksheets and it's a workshop, like you're working in those 3 days to put this.
Yeah, I love that event. Every time I come, I mean, you got some excited folks. You pack them in.
Well, you know, it's a blessing that people want to come and learn, I think. So
yeah, so very cool. Well, to sum up quickly, there are different avenues of leads, from the free ones to the paid. You can waste a ton of money and a lot of time. Bottom line is learn what you're doing before
learn
you
learn what you're doing, learn how to communicate, learn how to negotiate, learn how to run your numbers, and listen and find problems to solve.
And be patient.
Yes,
very much. Good. Zack Childress, smartest guy I know, although I never say that to your face. So folks want to learn more about you, the RIA, how do they get in touch with you?
Man, obviously we have the MadisonCountyRIA.com is our website. There's a lot of free stuff on there they can get. If you want a beginner's guide, it's free. You can go to localinvestorclub.com.
All right. And we will put a link below. And, of course, from this side of the table, we've got Revolved Realty, almost 100 agents. It's like herding cats.
200 by the end of the
200
year.
Well, it might be more than that. We got some things percolating maybe. But, yeah, so if you are interested in moving here, investing here, or if you're already here, and you would like our assistance, revolve.com is how you get in touch with us. So, all right, buddy. So until next week, I know you're about to go out to a property and deal with some contractors.
I am. Go walk a big 8,000 square foot building.
So. That's a lot of walking.
New event space coming to Huntsville.
All right. More to come.
That's it.
All right. We'll see you next time. Bye.